The 2020 NFL playoffs are going to be crazy. 7 teams make it now instead of 6, meaning a team with a potentially bad record could squeeze in due to the new format. For example, the Steelers at 8-8 last season for the AFC, the Rams at 9-7 the NFC. Those aren't bad records, but certainly really not playoff worthy, except for the Rams. This season, there are only a couple playoff locks in the AFC. The Chiefs, Ravens, Texans, Bills, and most likely the Patriots and Titans. Meaning, there's one more spot left in the AFC playoff race. There are a few obvious picks for the spot, the Steelers, Broncos, and Browns. There's one more team that I think has a much higher chance to make the playoffs than some people may think. The last time this team made the playoffs was 2016, when they lost in the first round. Obviously, the team I'm speaking of is the Las Vegas Raiders. During that 2016 season, quarterback Derek Carr was third in the MVP race, receiving 6 votes. That season, he threw for 3,937 yards, 28 touchdowns, and 6 interceptions, completing 63.8% of his passes and having a QBR of 96.7. All amazing numbers, and was looking to be on pace for a great career as the Raiders franchise quarterback. But as of late, he has not been performing up to the standards from the 2016 season. It is not completely his fault by any means. Amari Cooper began to underperform for them, so he was shipped off to the Cowboys. The defense has gotten a lot worse since they traded Khalil Mack to the Bears. Carr has been left with minimal weapons to have any success with for the past couple of years. Last season, his number one receiver was Tyrell Williams, who played 14 games, but was playing through injury during the season as well. And he only posted 651 yards and 6 touchdowns on 42 catches. And the wide receiver two was Hunter Renfrow, who posted similar numbers to Tyrell. My point here is that Carr's lack of personal success has not come from not being as good as he once was in that 2016 season, but how the Raiders front office has not given him any weapons to utilize in the passing game, except for this past season with the breakout tight end in Darren Waller, who posted amazing numbers for a tight end, with 90 catches, 1,145 yards, and 3 touchdowns. Yes, the 3 touchdowns is not great by any means, but besides that, he was outstanding for them. He really is the offense's only passing weapon. They do have a great running back group, with Josh Jacobs being a great first-round rookie for them, and Jalen Richard having an alright season as a backup. In only 13 games, Jacobs put up 1,150 yards and 7 touchdowns on 242 carries, averaging 88.5 yards per game and 4.8 yards per carry, which is just incredible for a rookie running back. Jacobs was an explosive back for the Raiders. According to PlayerProfiler.com, he evaded 81 tackles, which was 8th best in the league, and 6.2 per game, had 13 breakaway runs, which was 3rd best, and created 463 yards. That means he ran for 463 yards after what the O-line had already blocked for him, so basically running on his own, which was 9th best in the league. To say Jacobs is not a top 12 back in the NFL is outrageous, as he's one of the best talents I've seen in recent memory. And that is with only one not even full season under his belt. As a whole, this offense is no longer bad. They added wide receiver Henry Ruggs in the first round of the draft. I do not think they should have selected him over all the other wide receivers in the draft, but Gruden has always loved fast wideouts, so I think he will fit very well into the Raiders offense. They also added Nelson, no hands Aguilar, in free agency. Sorry Eagles fans, I know I just made you happy in my last video, but he really can't catch a ball to save his life. Although I'm not fond of Nelson Aguilar, he is still a good addition because he adds depth to the wide receiver group. The O-line is good though, with Rodney Hudson, Gabe Jackson, and Richie Incognito on the interior, and Colton Miller and Trent Brown at the tackle positions. Colton Miller next season will have a breakout year at left tackle. Colton is just a very skilled tackle, but like most rookies, he needed time to get adjusted to the league. Derek Carr is vastly underrated, and with his new weapons, great running back group, and a good O-line, I could see him having a good year next year. Not 2016 level, but not too far from it. To conclude the Raiders offense, I think it is in the middle of the pack, better than a good amount of teams in the race for the 6th or 7th seed in the AFC, like the Steelers and Broncos, and potentially the Browns if Baker does not do well again. But that's just a maybe. Moving on to the defensive side of the ball, the Raiders are very confusing there. Their defensive line is not great, but not bad. They found a gem in Max Crosby in the 4th round out of Eastern Michigan, and he put up 10 sacks while only starting 10 games and playing 72% of the defensive snaps. However, the other defensive end they drafted, Clelin Ferrell, who they selected 4th overall, has not played so well. Starting all 15 games that he played in, Ferrell put up 4.5 sacks while playing 62% of the defensive snaps. So that could turn out to be bad for the Raiders unless Ferrell picks it up this season. The Raiders also surprised people when they took him that high, as in some mock drafts they didn't even see him going in the top 16. And he was picked over Josh Allen, who went to the Jaguars, had a very productive rookie season. The Raiders messed up that draft pick. That's a fact. While having a huge hole in the defensive line, they could have went with Josh Allen or Brian Burns, which would have been great picks for their D-line, as both seem to be up-and-coming young stars coming off the edge. In the interior defensive line, they have Malik Collins and Maurice Hurst, both serviceable defensive tackles who plug holes in the trenches, and that is exactly what any team needs from their defensive tackles. You know, unless you're Aaron Donald. You're just like the best defense player in the league, and scare everybody in the history of the league. That might be a stretch, but you know what I mean. The linebackers are a bit weak outside of newly signed Corey Littleton, who is one of the best pass coverage inside linebackers in the league and is a one-time Pro Bowler. Those outside linebackers are Nick Kwiatkowski and Nicholas Morrow, who both have never put up over 70 tackles in a singular season once in their career. So to say that outside linebackers a position of need is an understatement. This is something the Raiders definitely should have addressed in the draft more than they actually did, as they only took one linebacker, Tanner Muse, in the third round. However, one position they did address in the draft is the defensive back group, taking Damon Arnette in the first round and Amik Robertson in the fourth round. Both are great picks considering where they were selected. Although Arnette could have slid a little further down the draft, they got exactly what they needed, which is all that matters. The other pieces in the secondary are free agency acquisition Prince Mukamara, Demaryius Randall, second-year safety Jonathan Abram, Trayvon Mullen, and LaMarcus Joyner. It's a good secondary. Randall's a starting caliber safety in the NFL and will be great in the Raiders scheme, but Jonathan Abram is very confusing. He's going into his sophomore season in the NFL and it's a huge question mark. He tore his rotator cuff early into last season, so nobody knows how he will play for the Raiders next year. I think it will be great for them, unless he gets injured again, or the recovery did not go well for him. But the more likely scenario is that those things do not happen. And if so, expect Abram to do big things in really his first NFL season. Mullen is an alright corner. Not too good, not too bad. There's nothing really special about him, nothing to really talk about with him. Lastly, in the secondary, you have LaMarcus Joyner, their nickel corner slash free safety. He did good against the run as their safety last season, but did pretty bad in the passing game. As according to Pro Football Focus, he had a 42.8 coverage grade, which is not good and not why the Raiders paid him $42 million over 4 years. He really will have to step up for the Raiders in coverage if he wants to A, keep a job on the Raiders, and B, help turn the defense around and make the playoffs. The defense as a whole is nothing special by any means, but has potential with some young pieces like Max Crosby, Clelin Ferrell, Tanner Muse potentially, and Damon Arnette. At worst, this defense will be the 20th best defense, but if Clelin Ferrell, LaMarcus Joyner, and linebackers step up, and Abram has a good sophomore season coming off injury, they could finish anywhere from 8th to 11th. Now, why do I think they'll make the playoffs? Simple. They are simply the second best team in their division. What about the Broncos, you may ask? They're a huge unknown. Who knows if Drew Lock is going to be good, or at least as good as we all think. The Chargers also have quarterback problems, and their defense is not as good as it once was. Tyrod Taylor is just a game manager, nothing more. I don't think the Chargers have the roster that allows a QB like Taylor to win a decent amount of games. The Raiders have the second best quarterback in the division, obviously second to Mahomes, so I think that is a huge plus for them, and that alone will bring them a long way next season. Now, onto their schedule. Their schedule is the 21st toughest with a strength of schedule at 0.497, so it is fairly easy for the Raiders to succeed. I can see them winning both games against the Chargers, split 1-1 with the Broncos, and probably lose both to the Chiefs. So in division, they're 3-3. They face the NFC South, and I see them going 2-2 against those teams, beating the Panthers and Falcons, but losing to the Saints and Buccaneers. Against the AFC East teams, they will go 3-1, only losing to the Bills. Yes, I have them beating my Patriots, even though it is in Foxborough, that'll be a surprise win for them. Then I see them losing to the Browns, but beating the Colts against former division rival quarterback Philip Rivers. So as a whole, they're 9-7, which is definitely enough for that 7th seed in the AFC. The Steelers last season went 8-8 and were the 7th seed in the AFC. Obviously, the playoffs are only 6 seeds, but if a team can go 8-8 and nearly make the playoffs in a 16 format, the 17 format will help the Raiders pull through come the postseason. However, I could see them losing to the Patriots or Colts, but I feel as if those games they could just win due to the new circumstances both of those teams are in. Talk about the new quarterbacks they have, of course. And those quarterbacks have had minimal time to get adjusted to their team's offense due to the coronavirus. Their whole schedule is fairly easy except for a couple of games, but I think their offseason additions, like the defensive help they added through the draft and signing Corey Littleton, as well as giving Derek Carr some weapons, and those weapons being a fully healthy Tyrell Williams and Josh Jacobs, as well as adding Henry Ruggs and Bryan Edwards in the draft, and Nelson Agholor in free agency, will all prove to be a huge help for the Raiders that will help them finally fulfill their potential as a team and win at least one or two more games. The Raiders simply just have a better and healthier roster than last year. That is all they needed, especially in the offensive side of the ball. Even without a real threat in the passing game, and subpar defense last season, the Raiders still went 7-9 in a very tough division. And now, their roster is clearly better than most of the teams in their division. Break down position by position, they proved to be the second best team in the AFC West. John Gruden has finally put together a recipe for success in Las Vegas, and there is no doubt in my mind that they will be in the playoff race. You know what? Forget that. They will be in the playoffs by the end of the 2020 NFL season. With all of that being said, that is it for me, guys. Thank you for tuning into Fanatic Sports. Hope you all liked the video. If you did, please subscribe and hit the like button. It only takes like 2 seconds. Also, follow me on Instagram, @FanaticSports25, and on Twitter, @FanaticSports. Thank you all for watching. Hope you all have a wonderful day.